PHP Presents Power Yoga by Caroline Bass.
Thank you so much for coming. You know, it all started with patient experience. And how do we inspire people to create that human experience? So there's a lot of questions that we couldn't understand initially. But eventually I found out that you cannot ask or tell or demand people to create patient experience. It has to come within. It has to come from inside of us. And our profession is very different with other service professions. It's not about patient satisfaction at all. You know, people who come into this hospital or to any other healthcare facility, they're not looking for having a good time. They're not here to have fun. It's very different. They're here because they're in pain. They have disease. They have problems and concerns for themselves and their family. So when they come here, they're looking for people who care. They're looking for people who care and they want to feel safe. They want to be taken care of. They want to have that with compassion and kindness, with dignity. And that's what human experience means when it comes to medical care. It has nothing to do with the satisfaction. It's not about the clean room and nice suit. It's about heart and how we care about them. So in order to inspire ourselves to do this human experience, it has to make sense. And the only way it makes sense, in my opinion, is that when you look at the medical profession, you think about medical profession as an incredible, magical things that we do for others. Something beyond and above ourselves as a purpose for life. So when you think about that way, when you perceive this profession that way, then it all makes sense. Creating connection with other people with kindness and compassion and care about them, to create that experience for others, it actually comes back to you as a human being, as a contentment, personal contentment. So it all requires personal growth and working on ourselves. And since this year, I promise we're gonna get together every time and talk about the strategies and ways that we can improve ourselves as a human being towards the best that we could be. And one of the things that we can talk about in personal growth and personal development is yoga. So I have the honor to have Caroline Bass, who's one of the good ICU nurses here in this hospital over last year. She's also, I didn't even know, and I'm very, very honored to tell you that she is actually a personal trainer for the last 13 years, and a yoga instructor for 8 years. And she's certified with the National Academy of Sport Medicine. And she's here to talk to us about yoga and show us what advantage yoga has for every one of us. Please, thank you.
So I'm gonna do a little bit of the nurse thing, and I wanna know, from a scale of 1 to 10, how stressed are you? Just
ten.
Really? From a scale of 1 to 10, how stressed are you? I want you just to put that number kind of in the back of your head, you know, that thing that's going on in your life. And we'll keep that for a little bit later. Today I want to talk to you about yoga. Now, I admit, well, the first time I did yoga, my mom was really into it, and she's like, come on, you gotta do it. And I'm into sports, and you know, in high school I did volleyball as MVP, and I did soccer in college. We were in the top 12 in the state, And she's like, come on, gotta do yoga. And the first time I did it, I swear to you, it was the most boring thing, and I couldn't wait to get out of the class. So about a year later, I went back and I said, you know, I actually feel a little better. That wasn't so bad. And then I started doing it again and again. And when I initially started doing it, I just wanted to focus on the physical side of it because that's who I am. So I was in for the stretching and I was in for the flexibility. And, you know, I was like, okay, this is good. And then I started to learn more about yoga. And I was realizing that I was getting kind of a partial benefit. So today I want to talk to you about the benefits of yoga, encompassing what is yoga, how is it going to benefit me, and what is the evidence behind it? Because that's what nurses and doctors, we're all about evidence, right? Let's show me the proof. So our objectives are to talk about the benefits of yoga and figure out what it is. We're going to go through mind, body, and spirit, the seven chakras. We're gonna go through some breathing, different types of breathing, and what that encompasses in yoga. And of course, our impact on patient care, because that's really what it's about here. And we're gonna do a little practice at the end. Okay, you're not gonna have to do a headstand. I might have you put your leg behind your head. I'll go over there and I'll fork, no, I'm just kidding. We're gonna do some very basic poses that have really good benefits behind it. And as we go through the poses, I will tell you what those benefits are. And we'll assess at the end how things went. So stress, we all have stress. I was stressed this morning. when we have stress, our body reacts. I love this chart. This is like a perfect chart of how your body responds to stress. Your sympathetic nervous system kicks in, you have epinephrine going, norepinephrine, increased blood pressure, increased blood viscosity, your clotting goes up, then you have your hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, which increases cortisol, which increases blood sugar, which causes dyslipidemia, and you know, you have inflammatory responses, and everything kind of goes haywire. This is what happens when we're stressed. And when we do that, we're prone towards disease. So the main purpose to bring this in is to yoga decrease stress. Stress can be good. We can have periods of stress where we get really focused or we get really intentional. But we want to take that stress and bring it into a balance. And yoga is all about balance. So, residents, I'd like a magic pill to fix my end-stage liver failure. Can you please give it to me? Right? I mean, how many times, I've even heard it when patients talk to you guys, and they say, please, I need something to fix this, and there is no fix. So what if I told you there was a magic pill, and the magic pill would improve your sleep, and decrease anxiety, and increase range of motion, and your energy would be better, and your life would be a whole lot better. Would you take the pill? All right. What if I told you the pill can only be made every 2 days because it'll actually deteriorate. So you have to take the pill, you have to get it to only 2 days at a time. Would you go to the pharmacy and get it every 2 days? Yeah. What if I told you that the pharmacy that makes the special pill is about 30 minutes away and you have to drive 30 minutes to get that special pill every other day? Would you still go and get it? So here's the thing, yoga can have many of those benefits. 30 minutes a day, 30 minutes every other day, and you can still receive those benefits. So I teach a hatha yoga. There's many types of yogas. Hatha yoga actually encompasses a wide range of different types of yoga. There are yogas where the instructor will walk around and like correct your form. There are yogas where they focus mainly on breathing and emptying the lungs of air and different types of breathing. There are yogas where the temperature is really hot, Bikram yoga. There are yogas where it's focused on just position changes. There are yogas that you use weights. There are yogas that you go through lots of rapid motions. There are slow yogas. It's all over the place. So hatha yoga is ha meaning sun and tha meaning moon. And the idea is that there's a balance of opposing forces. So you can have stress and you can have restfulness in the same state. I teach power yoga, which is focused on the physical fitness of it, with, you know, intense poses, but I also encompass the whole part of yoga. So what is yoga? When you think of yoga, kind of what do you think of? Maybe you think of this guy. Maybe that's your idea of yoga. Maybe you think of this girl. You're like, I can never do that. That's beyond my body's ability to move. All right, so what is yoga? Yoga is made up of three parts. The asanas, which is the poses. The parinamas, which is the breathing. And the meditation at the end. And I'm gonna talk specifically about those three and how to incorporate them for us. So I'm kind of a geek. I like the body. I like the physiology behind it all. I think the body is amazingly created and works so, just so great together. So we're gonna look at the physiology of the body. And I think too, when you look at how the body works, you're able to bring that into your practice in yoga. You can think about how the muscle fibers are working. So what are the physiological benefits of yoga? So it'll stabilize the autonomic nervous system. It's geared towards more parasympathetic stimulation. It'll increase your respiratory. Anybody RT here? Any RTs here? Oh, we'll have to get on them. All right. It'll actually increase your total tidal volume. Your EEG, your alpha waves increase. That is found in the occipital lobe of the brain. It's conscious restfulness when the eyes are closed. Blood pressure decreases, heart rate decreases, respiratory rate decreases. You know, it's like an increasing list that could probably go on and on. Your sleep gets better. You know, when you have better sleep, you know, life is better. All right, so I want to break it down to what does the muscle look like and how does it work? So your muscle is actually made up of two types of fibers, the myosin and the actin. The myosin is the thin fibers, the myosin is the thick fibers and the actin is the thin fibers. And they kind of slide past each other as they work. So when I'm practicing my yoga, I'm thinking, wow, my muscles are doing this and they're following the command of my body. And I just want to show you a short video if it works through as to how this works. But you actually have on the myosin, a little myosin head that attaches to the actin filament, and the actin filament will actually turn, attach, and then push. So all of this is going on while you do a simple movement. And I think that's just really amazing how the body has been created. So this is a 4-minute video. It's probably a little bit extensive, but like I said, I love this stuff. This is what it really is.
Muscles every day to do activities. This woman is using muscles to breathe, circulate blood, and move her hand to take notes. You use muscles every day to do activities. This woman is using muscles to breathe, circulate blood, and move her hand to take notes. Your cardiac and smooth muscle tissues are involuntary. You do not consciously control their actions. Skeletal muscle works under voluntary control. Skeletal muscles are composed of bundles of muscle fibers. Muscle fibers are long cylindrical cells containing several nuclei. Muscles will contract or relax when they receive signals from the nervous system. A neuromuscular junction is the site of the signal exchange. This is where the synaptic bulb of an axon terminal and muscle fiber connect. Muscle fibers are composed of many myofibrils. A myofibril contains contractile units called sarcomeres. Sarcomeres run adjacent to one another down the length of the myofibril. Each sarcomere consists of alternating thick and thin protein filaments, giving skeletal muscle its striated appearance. The muscle contracts when these filaments slide past each other. The thick filaments are myosin, which are anchored at the center of the sarcomere, called the M line. The thin filaments are composed of the protein actin, which are anchored to the Z lines on the outer edges of the sarcomere. Because the actin filaments are anchored to the Z lines, the sarcomere shortens from both sides when actin filaments slide along the myosin filaments. Although the action between the filaments is described as sliding, the myosin filament actually pulls the actin along its length. The cross bridges of the myosin filaments attach to the actin filaments and exert force on them to move. This action is known as the sliding filament mechanism of muscle contraction. In this model, the sarcomeres shorten without the thick or thin filaments changing in length. A contraction begins when a bound ATP is hydrolyzed to ADP and inorganic phosphate. This causes the myosin head to extend and can attach to a binding site on actin, forming a cross bridge. An action called the power stroke is triggered, allowing myosin to pull the actin filament toward the M line, thereby shortening the sarcomere. ADP and inorganic phosphate are released during the power stroke. The myosin remains attached to actin until a new molecule of ATP binds, freeing the myosin to either go through another cycle of binding and more contraction, or remain unattached to allow the muscle to relax. Muscle contractions are controlled by the actions of calcium. The thin actin filaments are associated with regulatory proteins called troponin and tropomyosin. When a muscle is relaxed, tropomyosin blocks the cross-bridge binding sites on actin. When calcium ion levels are high enough and ATP is present, calcium ions bind to the troponin, which displaces tropomyosin, exposing the myosin binding sites on actin. This allows myosin to attach to a binding site on actin, forming a cross bridge. Calcium ions are stored in the sarcoplasmic reticulum and are released in response to signals from the nervous system to contract. Neurotransmitter molecules are released from a neuron and bind to receptors, which depolarizes the membrane of the muscle fiber. The electrical impulse travels down the T-tubules and opens calcium stores. Calcium ions flow to the myofibrils, where they trigger a muscle contraction. As the actin and myosin slide along each other, the entire sarcomere shortens as the Z lines draw closer to the M line. As the sarcomeres in myofibrils contract, the entire muscle fiber will shorten. When muscle fibers contract in unison, a muscle can produce enough force to move the body, allowing you to take notes.
All right, who's taking notes? All right, I think that's amazing. Okay, so go ahead and just put your arms forward. Can you just imagine all those muscles that lifted just for you to do that? Bring your arms back down. So all those little muscle fibers are constantly doing that. By connecting with your brain and sending signals like that to make your body move. That's amazing. So, okay, let's see here. We'll get back to a little bit more on that in a little while. So we have two types of muscle fibers. We have fast twitch muscle fibers and slow twitch muscle fibers. The fast twitch muscle fibers give me burst movement. If I'm gonna jump, if I'm going to run, sprint, that's my fast twitch. And there's two types of fast twitch, but we don't need to go into that. The fast twitch muscle fibers, they tire out quickly. You can only run so long really, really fast. Your slow twitch muscle fibers, they retain more oxygen. They have more mitochondria, which processes that. And for that stance, they're endurance related. So your posture is your slow twitch muscle fibers. So how are you sitting right now? All right, so your muscles got a little tired, huh? Your shoulders coming in a little bit, maybe we can bring those back. So your posture basically is that slow twitch. And yoga does a lot to work on those slow twitch muscle fibers. So let's go ahead. That's the dark meat is actually because there's more mitochondria in the actual muscle cell. The white meat, or the burst of the burst power of the muscle, is because there's less mitochondria. It doesn't require as much oxygen. So we're gonna go into muscle contraction. There's three types of muscle contraction: isometric, concentric, and eccentric. So I want you to go ahead and sit up tall because we're talking about posture. So go ahead and kind of situate yourself into the chair. I want you to pull your belly button into your spine. Feel the contraction in. Draw your shoulders back. And if you're able to, put your feet flat on the floor. I want you to just pull the abs in tight and hold it there. Just hold it there for while I'm talking to you about muscle contractions. All right, this is your isometric muscle contraction. Your isometric muscle contraction is a steady state of contraction. No movement, but the muscles are tense. Those muscle fibers, the actin and myosin, are closer together. They're gonna stay that way. The concentric is the shortening of the muscle. So the easiest way is to think about your arm. As your arm goes up, your muscle contracts, it shortens, all right? The eccentric phase is actually the elongating phase of the exercise. The muscles get longer. There's actually a really good proof for when you do weightlifting, that is where the muscle gets the most benefit, is in the eccentric, not necessarily the concentric. So the good thing is when you're doing a weightlifting exercise, you're doing one or the other. When you come up, you're contracting the biceps. When you go down, you're relaxing the biceps. With yoga, you kind of do it all together. So this is a really good example of that. So when I'm here, my abs are contracted. Your abs still contracting?
Yeah.
All right. When I'm here, my abs are contracted. My triceps are contracted. Everything is isometric here. As I go down, as I go up into my down dog, rolling my shoulders back, now I'm stretching the hamstrings. I'm allowing that to stretch out. As the quadriceps pull back, you're going to feel a contraction here. The shoulders pull back, the chest gets shorter. So when I come down into a push-up, my chest is actually short here. My triceps are, okay, I gotta come up. All right, so as I'm here, when I go down, my chest is shorter, my triceps are long. As I come up, my chest is longer, my triceps are short. So in the yoga poses, you're actually doing all of these kind of all together. All right. Let's go into the mind, the yoga benefits of the mind. So to me, it's easy to come into the fact that yoga is good for the body. That's pretty easy to realize. You're moving, your heart is probably, you know, getting some work, your blood flow is going. That's easy for me. So how, this took a kind of a different step for me. How does yoga benefit my mind? So this is from Harvard Medical School. Harvard Medical School, direct quote: "The scientific study of yoga demonstrates that mental and physical health are not just closely allied, but essentially equivalent." So there are several different studies, and on these PowerPoints, you're gonna find that there's an email or a website on the bottom, and there's a reference page at the end. This will be online. You can go on and read about all of these things that I looked up for you. Really cool. Several different studies done. The University of Utah, 2008, did a study on pain perception. They found that matching up the same age, socioeconomic background, that people that practice yoga had a decreased response to pain when the same stimuli was applied than people that did not practice yoga. Let's see, the German study in 2009, they took two groups. This is all randomized controlled trials. And there were few randomized controlled trials, which is like the highest level of efficacy that you can establish in a trial. And there were few back then, but there are so many more coming out now. So this study put people into two groups, women that were experiencing depression for more than half of 90 days. So either 30, 60, or so on. More than half of 90 days. And they were either depressed, anxious, and their sense of well-being. That's what they that's what they measured. And they found that the people that practiced yoga, the women that practiced yoga, their depression decreased by 50%. Their anxiety improved by 30%, and their overall well-being, as they stated, improved by 65%. I think that's pretty, that's evidence, you know. Also, they're finding with PTSD, the soldiers that come back from Iraq or Afghanistan, about 20% of them are experiencing PTSD. So the government is like, well, what are we gonna do with this? And in Washington, D.C., the Walter Reed Army Medical Center is now offering yoga as a way to help these soldiers in the form of PTSD, and more tests are being done on that. But obviously they find the benefit enough to start that up. So one in every five adults experiences a mental illness, and one in every 25 experience or live with a serious mental illness. And you know, mental illness is kind of on the background. So this is something that can really help our overall well-being, and obviously it's something that we need. So the cognitive benefits: improves attention and concentration, memory, symbol recognition. So the brain, it actually has the inner part, the center, and the outer part. And yoga kind of uses both of those, kind of integrates both parts of the brain, and it actually draws in some focus to the inner part, or the subcortical of the brain. So some evidence on this. In 2012, they took 19 yoga practitioners and 19 controls. They matched them with age, gender, and education level. They were, through this series of tests, they were able to find that attention and concentration was better, because yoga practitioners practice that. You know, you can't get good at something unless you practice it. Remote memory was better, mental balance, delayed recall, immediate recall. I mean, these things are things that we all, you know, could benefit from. Like, you know, like forgetting your keys somewhere. Nope, nobody's like experienced that one before. All right, I need some more yoga. All right, I think this is really neat, and we're gonna actually do a little exercise here, because you've been sitting for too long and I've been talking for too long. So go ahead and stand up for me. All right, your mind, to figure out where your body is in space, your mind actually does a series of events that help you to establish how far you are from the next person, where your hands are, where your legs are. So you have these mechanical receptors, and they tell your body how much your muscles stretched so that you are better able to balance, right? So we're gonna do a yoga pose. You're gonna take your leg and draw it into your other leg and see if you can maintain your balance there. A little bit of practice, all right? We're doing good so far, yeah? Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and draw your hands to your heart center. This is your tree pose. This is the beginning level one in your yoga pose. Okay, a little wobbly sometimes, right? So your body is communicating through these receptors, all of these different parts of the brain to the muscle, getting back to the muscle. All right, we're doing good, right? So now, if you want, you can lift your leg up a little higher. All right, how's our balance? All right, muscles are contracting. You can feel a little muscle twitching, maybe, okay? Ankles are a little twitching, okay? All right, we're doing pretty good, right? Okay, I'm gonna shut off the part of your brain that's going to cause you to draw in a mind-muscle connection. Go ahead and close your eyes. All right, go ahead and relax before you, you'll fall over. All right, when you close the occipital lobe of the brain, it's cheating if you if you close off one part of the brain, you're now having to reroute these neurons to figure out where your body is, where your muscles are in space. Go ahead and sit down. So yoga works a lot with proprioception, where your body is in space. And to establish a real mind-muscle connection, you're able to focus in on that muscle and make that muscle contract. So go ahead and draw your abs in again. Pull that muscle in tight. Some people have a difficult time with pulling that muscle in because they've lost that mind-muscle connection. So yoga brings that all in together. All right, relax your abs. All right, another part of yoga, the breath. There are several different kinds of breath. You can breathe in through your mouth. You can breathe in through your nose. You can breathe in through one nostril, through the other nostril. You can breathe fast. You can breathe slow. So I've put together three different types of breath. So we're going to practice what ujjayi breathing, which is a very relaxing and energizing breath. So I want you to think about when you go to the beach and you can hear the ocean. Go ahead and just put your hands over your ears and listen to your breath. Go ahead and bring your hands down. Did you hear that sound of the breath? Almost sounds like the ocean. The inhale is kind of an S sound. The exhale is kind of an H sound. That's very energizing breathing. It's not diaphragmatic breathing. It's not abdominal breathing. It's not taking all the air out of the lungs. It's your normal breath at a calm and restful position. All right, we're gonna practice that in a little while. Kalabhati breathing, breath the fire. All right, yogis believe that there is stale air in your lungs that just stay there and it's stale. So you need to expel that air, or since there's no RT in the room, the peep, right? Oh, represent, good job. All right, the peep. We want to push that peep out because it's stale air. So the breath of fire is a little bit like this. It requires the abs to tighten and it pushes that stale breath out. We're going to do a pose in a little while that allows you to expel that breath. Now there's different ways to do the breath of fire. You could do short breaths and kind of get dizzy. People do it sitting down, but it's like this. All right, that's good for me. But there is a forceful breath that you can do with a yoga pose. So we'll practice this a little bit later, but we're gonna take our arms up and you're going to swoosh the air out and come back to full circle. This is a complete balance. You're coming down, bringing that air out and coming back up. As you do, when we do this, you're gonna keep your knees going straight back. It's not the hips that move, it's the arms that move. This right here could be bad for your knees. All right, so as you come up, you're gonna go shh, shh, expels that air out. All right, go ahead and stand up. All right, we'll stagger a little bit. You wanna, some people come up a little forward, some people go a little back. All right, you wanna have a good separation in the legs because we're coming down kind of into a squat. As you go down, you want your butt to go down and your knees to follow your heels. So you're in a good alignment. You do not want your knees coming forward above your toes, okay? We're going down like you're gonna sit down. Go ahead and take your hands up draw your fingertips together, just helps to get yourself ready. And we're gonna come down and, all right? And go ahead and come down. Expel that air. One more time. All right, go ahead and inhale, relax. Draw your hands down. Bring your hands back up. Inhale up. All right, we're gonna expel that air going into the opposite direction. One more time. Go ahead and come up, relax, and inhale, and go ahead and have a seat. Feel your heart beating a little bit? So yoga is not necessarily very slow, but it can be. This is one way it really pushes and works your heart, and it expels that stale air. All right, the last one is the Simhasana. This is the lion's breath. This one I'm going to save to the end, but it is one of the better breaths that we will discover a little bit later. All right. So our Ujjayi breathing is relaxing and energizing. This is what's mainly done throughout the yoga poses. This is what's mainly done throughout the class and into the end, really that energizing breath. So if I'm going to go into, let's say, a warrior one, where my feet are forward, back foot is at a 45 degree angle, got my heels to heels are straight, my hands come up, and my hips turn. So I'm here, I'm gonna take a breath. So that breathing is allowing the oxygen into the muscles. It's revitalizing your cells, and it's helping you breathe, because sometimes in exercise, people hold their breath. They'll go real, real fast, and then they're, right? So this is really focusing on bringing everything together. Yoga is really about the balance of bringing everything together. So the S on inhale and the H on exhale. We're gonna practice that. So go ahead and close your eyes for a second. Bring yourself into a comfortable seated position. All right. I want you to inhale through your nose and hold that air for just a half a second. And then as you exhale, you're gonna, okay. Now I want you to kind of think of expelling that air by tightening your trachea just a little bit. You're bringing that glottis in, closing that that area and tightening the throat, okay? And go ahead and inhale and exhale. You can go at your own pace. Now as you do, I want you to bring your awareness to your body. Allow yourself to breathe, bringing awareness to your body. All right, the best way is to allow yourself to make the sound. So inhale. All right, go ahead and relax and open your eyes. Especially when you start off, nobody wants to think, because you think like, am I smelling my breath? Am I breathing on somebody, you know? But really, it helps to tighten up the throat and allows you to control your breathing. It's not meant to make a loud noise. It's just meant for you to hear. So it doesn't have to be a loud, but you should be able to hear yourself breathe in that sense. All right, moving forward. The spirit. So this part, was a little bit hard for me. I struggled with this, especially in the beginning, because I need that magic pill, by the way. I struggled with it because I'm a Christian, and I thought, how can I practice yoga, being that it's kind of a Hindu, you know, practice, how can I do that? And I struggled with it for a while, but I really came to the realization that yoga is not about religion, it is about the spirit. And what yoga does is that it brings you to awareness of your spirit because of the balance of yourself. It says you have a spirit. Now, whether you choose to practice that in whatever religion you practice, that is your choice. But it's saying that you have a spirit. Acknowledge that your spirit needs to be fed and it needs to be strengthened. So, going on to the benefits of the spirit. Yoga talks a lot about the flow of energy. And when something impedes the flow of energy, it causes disease. So for example, if you get angry with someone and you have some unforgiveness against them, maybe you're rightfully so. Maybe they are completely wrong and they're being unreasonable. You hold this grudge against them. And what the seven chakras is about is that when you do that, you are impeding the flow of energy and you're therefore causing stress, which leads to disease. So the seven chakras is really a way for you to think about these areas of your life that you need to let things go, allow things to be, allow yourself to connect. All right, so the crown is the top of the head. It's being fully connected. It's your spiritual connection. Your third eye, or in your forehead, is your to see the bigger picture. You know, maybe you got mad at this person in your family, and maybe you're rightfully so, but the bigger picture is you want to be with them at Christmas time, so let it go. You know, that, see the bigger picture. Is it really worth being right, right? The throat is your ability to communicate. So I really worked on my throat chakra this morning, being able to communicate. Your heart, you know, to love others and to love yourself. And actually a great part of yoga is being okay with who you are and actually loving who you are, you know, instead of seeing all the flaws, seeing all the good that you have. The solar plexus is in the upper abdominal area. It's your confidence, your self-control, and your self-esteem. The sacral, lower abdomen, below the navel. And it's your new experiences, abundance, pleasure, sexuality. So they really think that some yogis believe that when you have different physical ailments that you need to focus on these areas of your life. Like if, you know, I'm constipated, then maybe my sacral chakra is off, so, something like that. All right, the root, the base of the spine right here makes you grounded, your financial independence. Your survival. So this is kind of where they come and they say, you know, let the energy flow through you. Really just recognizing the different areas of your life, and they kind of correlate it to different parts of your body. All right. Okay, so I am actually quite a fitness enthusiastic person, and I wanted to know why should I do yoga instead of go for a run? And I love running, and I love going to the gym and exercising, but you know, sometimes there needs to be a balance. And so I actually did the study. What's the difference between yoga and exercise? And I found there are very, very big differences. So yoga focuses on the parasympathetic stimulation, where exercise focuses on sympathetic. The subcortical regions of the brains are more activated, where in exercise, the cortical regions of the brain are the outer parts. We have slow, dynamic, static movements. Maybe you'll hold the pose for a little while and stay there, whereas with exercise, it's very, you know, bursts of energy. You have really low normalization of muscle tone, low risk for injury, lower calorie consumption. So if you exercise and you're gonna be more hungry, you're gonna wanna eat more. It's energizing, you feel that breath coming in and out of you, where breathing is taxing. You have to run, it's gonna take some, you know, breath out of you. These are just, you know, some of the things that I came up with, but there's actually some evidence behind this. I'll show you in the next slide. The positions of exercise in yoga are very, very different. So reciprocal inhibition is when one muscle contracts, the other one relaxes. So you see here, the bicep is relaxed, the tricep is contracted because his elbow is fully extended. So as this one relaxes, this one tightens. Well, in this picture, his bicep is shorter, it's tightened while the tricep is relaxed. Generally, you do one or the other. With yoga, you're doing it all. Every muscle is working at the same time in different ways. When I'm here in this pose, like he is, my quadriceps are contracted. My hamstrings are contracted. My gluteus is contracted. When I lift my chest up here, my triceps are contracted. Abdomen is tight. You know, you're doing it all at once together. All right, so here's the evidence. 2010, the Journal of Alternative and Complementary Medicine, they compared yoga to exercise, and they did an actual review of many, many different studies. And 81 studies were reviewed, and they found in disease populations or in healthy populations. And here are the different things that they looked at. So quality of life, pain, mood, heart rate, flexibility, balance. It's a very extensive list, stress. And what they found is yoga may be as effective or better than exercise at improving a variety of health-related outcome measures. Yoga interventions appear to be equal or superior to exercise in nearly every outcome measured except those involving physical fitness, meaning muscle mass. And you can, if you want to take a look at this, the chart actually will tell you this is the disease population, or the healthy population, disease population, and the benefits. And here are the more benefits. Yoga has more benefits than exercise, equal or similar, and less benefits than exercise. In your dubious spare time, you can check that out. All right, so the effect on healthcare. I find, I don't know about you, but I find that when I come to work and I am relaxed, I am ready, maybe it's been a couple of days off, I don't know. But you know, I come to work and I'm excited to be here. I give better care. If I have a bad day and I come in and maybe my coffee spilled on my leg as I got through the door, and maybe I got up late, it's just kind of try and put yourself together and make it through the day. Sometimes that happens, but we want to have less days where we just want to make it through the day, and more days where we're living fully to our potential benefit for what we were created. I was doing some research, and 80% of Americans don't like their job. That's huge. I am one that I can say I love my job because I get to come in and make a difference in somebody's life. And you know what? It might not be the patient, because maybe the patient, maybe they're in a tough spot. It might be the family member. It might be my coworker, right? So we have that opportunity to make a difference no matter what situation or where we're at, because we deal with people. I came to this hospital in a very tough situation. February of last year, or about January of last year, my dad had a stroke and he ended up here. And it was a seizure that led to a stroke. And I lived in Ventura, and I had graduated nursing school and was working at a very, very good hospital with an excellent new grad program for a few months. And this thing happened, and I had to make a choice. And I had my house there, and I moved in with my mom for a little bit of time and helped take care of him. February he passed away. And when you see the other side of healthcare, it's different. It's just different. Because you're no longer in control, right? So when he was here, I got to see really good nurses. And I got to see not so good nurses. And I said, you know what? I'm gonna be that nurse, not that nurse. I walk into a room and it doesn't matter what my day was, because I'm gonna be that nurse, not that nurse. So I came here after he passed away. A few months went by, and I came here and I said, I wanna work here, I wanna make a difference here. And when I see some of those good nurses here, I say, thank you. And some of them remember me. so we're here to help others, but we're here to make an impact. Whether on a patient, on a family, or on our coworkers, we're here to make an impact. And it's, what impact are you gonna make? Because you're gonna make one. What kind of impact are you gonna make? So that's my story. All right, so let's go ahead and practice some yoga. All right? You don't have to have a mat. You don't need to take your shoes off. Because all you need for yoga is you. That's it. So go ahead and just sit down on the floor in any place that you would like. This will not be, I will not make you do a headstand. This will not be crazy. It will be basic, and at the end, don't be nervous. At the end, we'll do a lion's breath. All right. Namaste is the way we can start a class or end a class. Go ahead and say namaste.
Namaste.
Namaste. All right. It just means that I acknowledge that there's a light in you, and I respect that light in you, and you respect that light in me. It's a very nice way of greeting somebody or saying goodbye to, you know, leaving. So at the end of the class, we'll say namaste. Can you say namaste? Let me take the lights down.
Oh. Okay.
Just the, maybe the second couple ones.
No, that's okay.
All right. All right, this is the best part because you're getting paid to do yoga. All right. If you'd like to take your shoes off, you can. If you don't want to, that's totally fine. I want you just to kind of close your eyes right now. It's hard to kind of get yourself in focus. I want you to take some cleansing breaths and just relax your mind. Go ahead and inhale through your nose. You exhale through your mouth. I want to hear that sound. I want you to breathe in positive energy, relaxing your body. Breathe out any stress, any anxiety. I want you to look within. Allow your mind to connect with your body, because this time is about you. It's not about me. I want you to focus in on breathing that air, inflating the lungs, exhaling the air out. Notice your posture. Connect with your muscles. What feels tight? What body parts feel tense? Tension is generally found in the jaws, the shoulders, the back, and the hips. Connect with your body. Allow your facial muscles to relax. Bring yourself into the right mindset of what you are here for. Go ahead and rotate your neck around, all the way around. Draw your chin down to your chest and coming all the way up and through. Stretching out the scaly muscles and the sternocleidomastoid. As you go around, I want you to notice particularly a spot that might be more tense. If you do notice that spot, go ahead and just hold it there for a few seconds and then continue around. You're increasing the flexibility in your neck. Yogis also believe that this improves the cerebral spinal fluid to the brain. Go ahead and rotate it in the opposite direction, releasing the tension, allowing your body to connect with your mind, bringing yourself into focus. About you right now. Draw your chin down to your chest. Relax there for a second. You can lace your fingertips together and relax your hands on the back of your head and just allow the pressure of your arms, no weight, just the weight of your arms to draw forward onto your head so that stretches the back part of the neck, just right on the top of the head. Relax the neck. Go ahead and take the hands all the way up, keep the fingertips interlaced, and you're gonna extend forward. This is very good for the latissimus dorsi muscle. Opens up the posture. All right, I want you to go ahead and release that tension. Inhale, draw the fingertips to the back, lace them together, drop the chin down, and drop forward, and exhale. It's difficult to lace the fingertips. You can just draw the palms back. You don't have to lace. This is stretching the biceps and the chest. Excellent for improving posture, releasing tension in the biceps, chest, and shoulders. Go ahead and slowly bring yourself up. You're gonna go ahead and take your knees, draw them down towards the floor, and bring your hands to the front. We're going to go into our cat-cow. I want you to keep your back nice and flat. Notice where your back is. A nice, even curvature of the spine. We're going to take an inhale, draw the chin into the chest and round the back. Draw the gluteals in and pull the shoulder blades apart. As you lift your chest in, your back comes up. And then when we come up, you're going to draw your chin up, your eyes go to the back of your head, and your back dips in. This is really working on the core muscles, all right? We're gonna inhale and draw up. Deep breath in. Feel the stretch into the scapula and exhale, draw up. Drawing your eyes to the back of the head. Rotate the hips and feel the stretch in the abdomen. This is excellent core work. Inhale, draw in. Bring in that mind-muscle connection. What muscles do you feel tightening? Go up. Go ahead and exhale up. This is your cat cow. One more time. Inhale in. Round the spine. Pull the shoulder blades apart. Draw the hips in. Almost as if somebody is grabbing you from the belly and pulling you up. And then go ahead and gravitate up. Draw the eyes to the back. Lift the chin. This is excellent for the thyroid. Draws the hips in. Excellent. And tighten the back. Go ahead and bring yourself into a nice neutral. You're going to curl your toes in the back. Take an inhale and then lean back into your down dog. Down dog. Your bottom is up and your legs are down, grounded onto the floor. If you have really tight muscles, you don't have to bring your heels all the way down, but I want you to lean back and feel the stretch into the hamstrings. I want you to feel the stretch into the hips, into the lower back. All right, go ahead and take a couple steps forward with your hand and draw yourself into your plank pose. Plank is a nice strong core pose. Draws tension into the triceps, the abs, and the chest. Go ahead and take a cleansing breath, breathe in, and strong exhale back into down dog. Take a couple of steps back with your hands and lean back. Doesn't that feel much better than plank?
Hate plank.
I want you to feel the stretch going into your calves. We're going to take it into our walking dog. So you're going to bend one knee and rotate the hips. As you do, you're going to feel the stretch into the calves, really working, stretching the hips, the IT band, especially if you do a lot of running or walking. This position is excellent for depression, increases blood flow to the brain, excellent for diabetics, improves neuropathy. All right, we're gonna take a step forward with your right leg and bring your head up. You feel that blood rushing from the head down into the body.
No, it has to be just like this.
And yoga is very fun, so laughing is allowed. All right, in this pose, this is your runner's lunge. I want you to lean your weight forward to stretch out your hip flexors. You can keep your knee down onto the floor, or you can lift the knee up. It's completely optional. The knee down onto the floor is a little bit of a softer pose that gives you more control. Bringing the leg up works a little bit more on strength and balance. Feel the strength coming into the quadriceps. Feel the stretch into the hip flexor. All right, you are gonna take it up into our warrior one. So there's two ways of doing it. You can keep your back straight and slowly lift up, or gently draw yourself up by pulling the leg in and then getting into your pose. Whichever way works better for you. All right, I want you to check out your heels. I want to make sure your heels are straight, front heel to back heel. The back foot is at a 45 degree angle. Your arms are up with the palms facing each other. Go ahead and pull the hips in to face forward. It's going to kind of feel like a sideways. And I want you to feel maybe some strain into that back leg. You're going to feel the stretch into the hip flexors. Go ahead and take an inhale, slightly draw the knee back, and exhale, draw the leg forward. And inhale, and sink into that pose. All right, now take that back foot, you're gonna inch it back just a little bit, inch it back, and draw your arm forward and one arm back. I want you to notice your palms so that they're facing down towards the floor. And the hips kind of come forward in this pose. Palms are down. You feel the strength coming from the quadriceps. I want you to tighten up the ab muscle, bring it in, rotating the hips just slightly. Go ahead and take an inhale. And as you exhale, you're gonna draw your hand up and relax back. Go ahead and lean that back knee back. Relax your body. This is stretching your latissimus dorsi, also external obliques. A little tightening up in the low back. Go ahead and bring that hand back down, bringing yourself back into warrior two. All right, you're gonna take that back foot and inch it forward a little bit and turn yourself towards the side, bringing your hands together. So you're in a side position. I want you to rotate your toes just slightly so that they're going the same direction as your knees. We're gonna do our fire breath. As you come down, go ahead and exhale. As you come up, inhale. Go ahead and down. And exhale. And one more breath. Expel that cold air. You're gonna inhale and relax your arms all the way out and bring it down. Come down, bend your knees, reaching down onto the floor. You're grabbing a gift. coming all the way up and breathing in. And one more time, go ahead and take it down. Nice, relaxing, cleansing breath, bringing it up, inhale. All right, exhaling, we're gonna go in the opposite direction with our fire breath. Exhale and release that stale air. Strong breath. One more. Go ahead and inhale down, relax, all the way down. Grab yourself a gift, exhale, inhale up. One more breath, coming all the way down. Relax yourself, reach down, and coming back up. Gonna take that front hand, draw it towards the front. We're going back into our warrior two. You can slide that back foot, making sure you're in a good posture, good position. And then now we're gonna go ahead and take our hands, draw it forward and bend the knee to the back, bringing yourself back into your runner's lunge. All right, gonna take a giant step back or slowly bring your knee back, whichever way works best for you. A nice plakasana, back into plank. You're gonna chaturanga down, inhale, and exhale, come up into your cobra. If you have some back problems, you can do it a gentle way by keeping your knees down and doing it this way. Whichever way works best for you. All right, going back into down dog, exhale. Draw your hands back slightly. Chaturanga coming down into your cobra. Lifting up, working the chest and triceps, and strong breath back into your down dog. Take a giant step forward with your opposite leg, and we're into our runner's lunge. All right, remember you can keep that back knee straight, or you can take it down onto the mat for a little bit better stability. All right, feel that stretch into the hip flexor. Allow your body to connect with your mind. Feel the muscles that are tense. Feel your heart racing. All right, we're gonna go ahead and slowly draw yourself to that back leg straight and bring yourself up into your warrior one. All right, stretching the hips in the back. Keeping that front toe forward, the back foot is at a 45 degree angle. Draw your hips to the front, really, really pushing at that gluteal muscle to draw the hip forward. Feel the stretch in the hip flexors. The flexors are incredibly important for posture. Draws the hamstrings really tight and really draws your body in. So very important for stretching. All right, we're gonna take a deep breath in, relax the knee back slightly. Now sink into that pose and exhale. Feel yourself into that pose. Feel the quadricep muscle working. Tighten up the glutes. Allow your body to draw in everything that you can. Go ahead and relax and fatten your back. And inhale down. I'm gonna draw that front arm forward and inch that back foot for your warrior two. Now go ahead and draw the hip in. And you're nice into that strong pose. Feel that strength coming from the quadricep. Lift that front arm up and lean back. Feel the stretch coming down. Stretch is excellent for good posture. Very good for stretching the lats and the obliques, external and internal. Coming down into your warrior two. I'm gonna go ahead and turn the feet so that the toes are facing the opposite direction. Draw your hands all the way up. And nice, three strong Kalabata breaths. And exhale down. And rid yourself of that stale air. Exhale down. One more time. Coming all the way to the top. Extend your spine and inhale, relax, exhale, and grab onto that gift. And lifting all the way up, inhale, extend, and exhale on the way down. Drawing yourself in, and inhale on the way up. Feeling that soothing and relaxing breath. We're gonna go in the opposite direction. Fire breath. Exhale down. And exhale down. Last breath. Rid yourself of that air. You're filling yourself anew now. Go ahead and take it all the way down. Exhale down. Relax. Inhale up. Feel yourself breathing in fresh, clean air. Exhale down. Reaching down. Inhale up. Alright, gonna take that front foot, turn it again, and bring yourself back into your warrior two. Take that back foot, inch it back. Alright, gonna slowly come down. Take that back knee down onto the mat. Move back into your runner's lunge. Take a giant step back or slowly bring yourself back and down into your Pottasana. Coming all the way down, Chaturanga, inhale up, curl the toes and draw back. Don't worry, we're almost done. And slowly Chaturanga down, inhale. And exhale, lean back. Feel the benefits of that stretch. Slowly draw your knees down onto the mat. You're gonna inhale up into your cat, into your cow. Inhale, open up the shoulder blades. Exhale, lifting the chin up into your cat. Inhale up, pull the shoulder blades apart, draw the hips in, and exhale up. The eyes go to the back of the head, curl that spine, and bring yourself into neutral. Go ahead and slowly lean back and draw yourself into a seated position. All right. Just feel your heart racing. Let's see what my heart rate is. We're going to take a few cleansing breaths to relax ourselves. All right. I'm going to take you through the Shavasana. This is the most important part and the most difficult part of yoga. Because it requires so much of you. It requires all of you present in this moment, ready to take this journey with me. You can just find yourself in whatever comfortable position you can bring yourself in. I want you to close your eyes. Let's go ahead and take some cleansing breaths and inhale. Slowly let that air out. Sounds for controlling the breath. Yoga is about uniting mind, body, and spirit, coming together in unity for perfect health. You get outside thoughts, you allow them to come in, and then you allow them to refocus you back to yourself. This is time for you to draw from within. Try to relax that breath as your heart rate slowly comes down. Go ahead and take those nice deep inhales. I want you to imagine yourself sitting down on the sand, the beach in Hawaii. There's a nice cool breeze going through your ears. It's early in the morning. The air is crisp. You can almost taste the ocean water as you watch the waves crash on the sand. I want you to feel the sand in between your toes as you sit there by yourself. The sun has just come up. Cool air is refreshing to your skin. I want you to look to the horizon. See the wonderful things that are ahead for you in your future. See the sun beating down on the ocean. glistens. The roar of the waves crashing down on the sand. The sand is cool since early in the morning. A little bit moist. You feel a calming spirit. Suddenly look up in the far distance. You see somebody running towards you. You can't quite picture who it is yet. They're looking at you. You look at them and you're thinking, I wish this person was here. This would make it a perfect moment. Before you can see, you can hear their voice calling your name. And instantly you know the moment could not be any better as the person arrives and embraces you with both arms. Pleasant surprise. You both sit on the sand. This moment, because life is about sharing moments with others, living each moment. Arms all the way up, bringing your hands together. Go ahead and slowly draw your hands to heart center, feeling yourself relaxed, completely at ease. Go ahead and inhale, reach your hands all the way up, bringing down peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control, but most importantly, remembering to love. One last breath. Inhale, reach all the way up. Coming down to a peaceful soul and a forgiving heart. Holding on to no grudges. Loving freely. My soul honors your soul. Namaste. So, from a scale of 1 to 10, how stressed do you feel right now?
You know,
I'm just
fine.
All right, I guarantee the alpha waves in your brain are increased at this moment. All right, we do have one more thing. Do you remember? I did not forget. And I have one more thing for you. Hasana, the lion's breath. All right, this is our last pose where we can release our energy. Go ahead and draw onto your knees, bring in your hands right at your quadriceps. You're gonna roll your shoulders back and you're gonna get into a strong pose, a conquering pose, all right? You're going to draw your air in. Go ahead and take your eyes back behind your throat and stick your tongue out. I do not see everybody doing this in Hasana. You have to conquer your day, all right? Palms in, you can't see because your eyes are supposed to be behind you, all right? Palms in front of your, on your quadriceps, draw the shoulders back. Take a nice deep inhale. Draw the eyes to the back of the head and exhale.